Hare Krishna. So with the permission of my God brother Shyama Rupa Prabhu and all the assembled devotees, we can get started what is supposed to be the last class. All right, we'll discuss about that. So, page 104. I'll start with the bhajan because we have a couple of more minutes for the others to come. And in the meanwhile, for those who are on time, it's the great reward to meditate on Srila Rupa Goswami and seek his blessings. This is page 104, Sri Rupa Manjari Pada. So it's on page 104. Manjari Pada. I don't know if it is there or not. Hare Krishna. Shri Rupa Manjari Pada Shai Mora Shampada Shai Mora Bhajan Pujana. Shri Rupa Manjari Pada Shai Mora Shampada Shai Mora Bhajan Pujana. Shai Mora Abharana Shai Mora Prana Shai Mora Prana Dhana Shai Mora Abharana Shai Mora Jiva Nirjivana. Shai Mora Rashanidhi, Shai Mora Mancha Shiddhi, Shai Mora Vede Radharama. Shai Vrata Shai Tapa Shai Mora Mantra Japa Shai Mora Dharam Karama. Anukula habe bidhi shei pade hoibe siddhi nirakhibo ei dui nayane. Anukula habe bidhi shei pade hoibe siddhi nirakhibo e dui nayane. Shrupa Madhuri Roshi Prana Kuvalaya Shashi Prapulita Habe Nishidine. Shrupa Shri Rupa Madhuri Rashi Pranakuvalaya Shoshi Prapulitaha Benishi Dine. Tuya adarshana ahi gara le jarolo dehi chirodina tapita jivana. Aha prabhu koro doya deha mare pado chaya Narottama loi lo sharana. Aha prabhu koro daya deha mare pado chaya Narottama loi lo sharana. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada. Jaya Guru Deva, Jaya Guru Deva, Guru Deva, Jaya Guru Deva. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. So I welcome all the devotees, and what is supposed to be the last class today, but we'll discuss about that when more of the devotees come, and then everybody knows. So we start off with our traditional Mangalacharan prayers, and then we can get going.
Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guroha Shri Utapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tvam Sajivam sadvaitam savadutam parijana sahitam krishna chaitanya devam shri radha krishna padan sahagana lalita shri vishakanvitamscha he krishna karuna sindho dina bandho jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhayascha Kripa Sindubhya Evacha Patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Matsamo nasti papatma, na paradi chakaschana, parihare pilajjame, kimbhruve purushottama, bhumau skalita padanam, bhumireva valambanam, tvai jata paradhanam. Tvameva sharanam prabho adadanas trinam dantair idam yache punah punah srimad rupa padam bhojo dhulisyam janma janmani rajoham syam bhave bhave radha radita radhesha radhika prana vallabha radha ramana vandetvam radhika prema nirjita
Hare Krishna. So, the plan or the program is something like this. We'll try to cover up to the sadhana bhakti stage today. The nectar of devotion is divided in 19 chapters as far as the first goes. And amongst them, there are four waves, which is Samanya Bhakti, Sadhana Bhakti, Bhava Bhakti and Prema Bhakti. So the Sadhana Bhakti stage, actually the Samanya Bhakti is covered in preface, introduction and chapter 1, from chapter 2 through chapter 16 is Sadhana Bhakti. And then chapter 17 and 18 is Bhava and chapter 19 is Prema. So, we cannot cover up till the 19th chapter, so we definitely will have one more class after this. Amongst the sadhana, which covers from 2 through 16, the Vaidhi sadhana covers from 2 to 14, and 15 and 16 is Raganuga, or the spontaneous devotional service. So, we might get to point 14 today, 14th chapter, up till that point, and then probably we'll try to have one session where we cover the remaining of the chapters. What is Raganuga, what is Bhava, and what is Prema? So that is the program for today. Do you have questions, comments, concerns? I thank you for taking your valuable time to come, because you could have been anywhere doing anything, but you are here. Thank you. Gauravji, you have any questions, comments, concerns? Yes, Sridhar. I will get to that. I think mostly I'll start with 6 today. Just we'll have the 64 items of devotion. We'll go over them. And then probably we'll go through the chapters. The remaining of the chapters, Srila Rupa Goswami actually, he gives scriptural evidences on why he quoted what he quoted. Hare Krishna, thank you for coming in the back. All right. So we can start from the front, since they are very brave. We can start with Simantini Mataji and go to her right in that way. So we do 10 each. And then, is that, no, it's not chapter number 6, but chapter number, where are the 64 items mentioned? 7? 8. Eight is offenses to be avoided, right? Okay, so I think we can do with 8, that is also fine. 6, right? Yeah, so here, these are 64 items. Yeah. So let's do the 64 items and then we can go. Actually, if that is the case, because 6 is our basis, then we'll do one paragraph each. In that way, we can keep going. But when we come to the offenses, then we can do 10 each, because that's a huge thing. All right, so Simantini Mataji, you can start with the first paragraph and then the second paragraph, on and on up till the last paragraph on page 54, where we can split up into 10 each. So please go ahead.
Okay. Srila Rupa Goswami states that his elder brother, Sanatana Goswami, has compiled Harivikta Vilasa for the guidance of the Vaishnava, and therein has mentioned many rules and regulations to be followed by the Vaishnavas. Some of them are very important and prominent, and Srila Rupa Goswami will now mention these very important items for our benefit. The purport of the statement is that Srila Rupa Goswami proposed to mention only basic principles, not details. For example, a basic principle is that one has to accept a spiritual master. Exactly how one follows the instruction of his spiritual master is considered a detail. For example, if one is following the instruction of his spiritual master and that instruction is different from the instructions of another spiritual master, this is called detailed information. But the basic principle of acceptance of a spiritual master is good everywhere, although the details may be different. Srila Rupa Goswami does not wish to enter into details here, but wants to help before us only the principles.
Continuing, he mentions the basic principles as follows. 1. Accepting the shelter of the lotus feet of a bona fide spiritual master. 2. Becoming initiated by the spiritual master and learning how to discharge devotional service from him. 3. Obeying the orders of the spiritual master with faith and devotion. 4. Following in the footsteps of great acharyas, teachers under the direction of the spiritual master. 5. Inquiring from the spiritual master how to advance in Krishna consciousness. 6. Being prepared to give up anything material for the satisfaction of Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. This means that when we are engaged in devotional service of Krishna, we must be prepared to give up something which we may not like to give up. And also we have to accept something which we may not like to accept. 7. Residing in a sacred place of pilgrimage like Dwaraka or Vrindavana. 8. Accepting only what is necessary or dealing with the material world only as far as necessary. 9. Observing the fasting day on Ekadasi. And 10. Worshipping sacred trees like the banyan tree.
These 10 items are preliminary necessities for beginning the discharge of devotional service in regulative principles. In the beginning, if a neophyte devotee observes the above mentioned 10 principles, surely he will quickly make good advancement in Krishna consciousness.
The next set of instructions is listed as follows. 1. One should rigidly give up the company of non-devotees. 2. One should not instruct a person who is not desirous of accepting devotional service. 3. One should not be very enthusiastic about constructing costly temples or monasteries. 4. One should not try to read too many books, nor should one develop the idea of earning his livelihood by lecturing on or professionally reciting Srimad Bhagavatam or Bhagavad Gita. 5. One should not be neglectful in ordinary dealings. 6. One should not be under the spell of lamentation in loss or jubilation in gain. 7. One should not disrespect the demigods. 8. One should not give unnecessary trouble to any living entity. 9. One should carefully avoid the various offenses in chanting the holy name of the Lord or in worshipping the deity in the temple. 10. One should be very intolerant toward the blasphemy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, or his devotees.
Without following the above-mentioned 10 principles, one cannot properly elevate himself to the platform of sadhana bhakti or devotional service and practice. Altogether, Srila Rupa Goswami mentions 20 items and all of them are very important. Out of the 20, the first three, namely accepting the shelter of a bona fide spiritual master, taking initiation from him and serving him with respect and reverence are the most important.
Thank you. So, any questions, doubts? So, you know, with all due respects, I'll have, because it's afternoon, 2 o'clock, hot outside. You feel like doing some other activity than sitting for the Bhakti Shastri class. It is mentioned one should not give unnecessary trouble to the living entities. So if I give you exam, it's a necessary trouble.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Yes. Hare Krishna. Yes, Prabhu, I can hear you.
This is Srinivas. I have a question.
Yes, Prabhu.
I'm hearing echo. Hopefully, you're not hearing echo.
No, not now. Yes.
Yeah, the one should rigidly give up the company of non-devotees. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure. So, in the olden times, it was actually possible to avoid association with those who are not devotees. In fact, in Chaitanya Charitamrita and other places, we could see there was a clear distinction. Advaita Acharya and others, they would be amongst themselves and they would be persecuting their devotional activities with no concern with others. Others would blaspheme them, hey, these are Vaishnavas. There was a clear demarcation. But in the modern age, when we have to go to work, we have to deal with family members who are not devotees, or we have friends who are not devotees. The idea is that to the extent they are not influencing our devotional service, A, and B is to the extent we have to deal with them to get whatever life that we have to get on, that's what is needed. The problem is that if one reveals one's heart to those who are not devotees, they may have very best intentions for you. But the solutions, because they are on the material platform, are often detrimental. If you have a colleague, you know, who likes to consume alcoholic beverages, and he finds or she finds some satisfaction and they forget stuff, and they are, in general, when they consume it, they are happy, and you are having stress at work, you go and tell that person, look, there is so much of work, I have stress. Come join, let's go. You know, he'll also provide some alcoholic beverages, you will forget. His intention may be right, but the solution is horribly wrong. You get it? So to the extent that we can associate with others without our own devotional service getting impacted, to that extent you should. And part of the necessary thing is you should do it. I mean, I'll give you another graphic example. So as soon as you go, usually people go to the office and when they join a new office, then they ask for certain things. For example, there's a computer here, I need a screen so that my eyes won't get affected. Or I need an ergonomic chair because I have a back problem. Or so on and so forth, and it's common. Imagine you join a company and you go to the HR and you say, I want a cage to be built outside my cube, and you set it on fire. Because it is mentioned in the scriptures, it is better to be in the cage lighted up by fire rather than to associate with non-devotees. I was taking it to a graphic example, but the point is, you get the idea. To the extent, you should. Even amongst the so-called non-devotees, you should also make discrimination. They might be really respecting your beliefs, and they may be kind of be tolerant. So, you know, those who are completely antagonistic and try to pull away, then you have to be careful. But with those who are genuinely respecting with what you do, then it's okay to open, you know, or tell your problems. So it's just on a case-to-case basis. But having said that, there is always this risk that when you associate intimately with non-devotees, you develop their desires just like them. It's just a matter of time. So one has to be careful. Vyayato vishyan sangha sangas teshu pajayate sangha sanjayate kamaha kamat krodho vijayate. So it is just a matter of time before that rubs off on you. So it needs to be taken with a grain of salt. Other question, Srinivas Prabhu? Is that okay?
Excellent, Prabhu. Thank you very much. It's very detailed. And
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Thank you. Yes, Ashok.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
So this, the number 10, one should be very intolerant towards the blasphemy
yes,
of the Supreme Person.
Yes, I remember that question.
Last time you asked me to remind.
Yes, thank you for reminding. And later when we come, there is a section actually that kind of describes in detail, and we'll get into that a little more detail.
And one more question, Prabhu.
Yeah.
Chapter 6, rule number 6.
Okay.
So here it is said that we have to leave something which may not like to give up, and we have to accept something which may not like to accept. Is it something particular to a person, or is it something that, you know, the general principles, four regulative principles?
Four regulative principles, or it could be, in general, anything that takes away. Because part of surrender to Krishna is anukulyasya and pratikulyasya. So which means accepting favorable things to devotional service and rejecting things which are, but I like things which are unfavorable to devotional service. Therein lies the problem. For example, last class we were discussing about, say, going on internet. Too much of internet browsing. It's easy to get lost. I admit to the august audience that I do get into that bad habit sometimes. You just go to internet for something, 3 hours later you kind of even forgot what you came for. There was, I had to look at some email and answer that email, but as soon as I logged in, there was some link that caught my attention, and on it went. So, which was why I became very cautious and cancelled my Facebook account. Thank you. if it is used in devotional service, you should use it. Anything that can be used, this is another point which we'll come across later. Anything that can be used in service of Krishna, you should. If Facebook can be used in service of Krishna, if Twitter can be used, please use it by all means. But, yeah, does that a little bit answer your question? The other point will come.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Mataji. Simantini Sakhi Mataji.
Hare Krishna. So Prabhu, here, number 3, they said, one should not be very enthusiastic about constructing costly temples or monasteries. So can you explain that a little bit?
The idea that the acharyas have said is that anything that needs a lot of money and endeavor, that is over-endeavor or atyahara. It's not something that is in general to be encouraged. But if there are like big projects within ISKCON, yeah, if that was Prabhupada's desire, then yeah, we can. But otherwise, in general, there's so much of endeavor, there's so much of maintenance, It creates service opportunities, but at the same time it causes endeavor. And you might say that Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami, they also constructed magnificent temples in Vrindavan, so aren't they kind of not following what they wrote for us? The thing is, they never chased for the temples. That was one of the orders by Mahaprabhu. But if you can see, somehow or other, they got the necessary funds. They prayed intensely for the temples to come about, but it happened later when they started doing all their work. Then, you know, the story of Sanatana Goswami about how a famous merchant came, and then one of the kings sponsored Goidadev's temple, so on and so forth. So they happen, but when you take it on your head that my mission in life is to build a big temple and then take so much of endeavor for it, and then how is your chanting, Prabhu? Well, I'm building a big temple. So that's the problem. See, that's where we get sidetracked. So the basic principles of sadhana should be strong. On that note, before we moved into this temple, there was an endeavor actually to get secure a property for Madan Mohan. And Vaisheshika Prabhu's idea was to consistently have a center where we could hear and chant, more than, you know, the magnificence of the structure and so on and so forth. So by hearing and chanting, actually that was what his policy was. You hear and chant, temple will come of its own accord. So we did endeavor, but not like an over-endeavor, where we had to raise millions and millions of dollars and build like a huge temple made of finest Italian marble or whatever. We're happy doing hearing and chanting. So that should be the kind of the general mood. The sadhana is the foundation, it should be strong. And on top of it, yeah, it's a little controversial topic, given that ours is an expanding movement. That's another point. We can build a hut and be in a hut and put Radha Madan Mohan in a hut or in a bag, like Sanatana Goswami did. Huh? Yeah, he does that. So, but might, for preaching purposes, sometimes you might argue you might need. The other place, I did find few temples within ISKCON where hearing and chanting and congregation development was the primary focus, taking care of devotees. And then the temple naturally grew because, you know, they needed a place. Even our small temple in Bascom, it outgrew like anything. Everybody was saying, we need a new place. We need a new place. Let's get a new place. It's not like, you know, as soon as the congregation came out, okay, we need a magnificent temple with like 20-acre property and then so much of endeavor. Yeah. It's a case-by-case situation, but the general principle is that our hearing and chanting should be first. And the temple will come. Does that little bit answer your question?
Yeah, it's perfect. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you. Yes, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
The point, second point, it says, one should not instruct a person who is not desirous of accepting devotional service. But in Srimad Bhagavatam, it says, a Vaishnava should always try to preach or try to instruct persons to initiate or believe in Krishna. So is it not contradicting?
So it's one of the things that is offenses against the holy name is to preach the glories of the holy name to a faithless person. And it's actually an offense against the holy name. But the holy name itself is very liberal, that anybody can utter without any previous qualification. So while we try to do good to others, it depends on the person who's actually taking that. If you preach about devotional service and they blaspheme the Lord, the problem is you are put into difficulty. We'll come to that blasphemy point, which ties up into this question. It will, because they don't know who God is. They are so atheistic, they actually will dare to blaspheme God right in front of your face when you are actually telling about Him. So you have to hear to that blasphemy. So it is said in that section that those who tolerate and sit and listen to the blasphemy of the Lord or His devotees, he or she loses her or his pious credits. Do you really want to get into that? So you have to be intelligent in knowing when to and how to. Having said that, Hare Krishna Mahamantra can be chanted. Hey, I'll tell you a mantra. Vaisheshika Prabhu's trip. I'll tell you a mantra, chant. They'll chant. They didn't know what it was. They didn't know what they chanted. But the effect was there. I'll tell you another tip. If you feel inclined towards the homeless who stand on the streets with their placards and they are waiting for money, so you can give them 10 cents, 15 cents, but you should first say, chant Hare Krishna. Just even don't even the Maha Mantra, because the traffic light might come and go fast. Just chant Hare Krishna. It's Hare Krishna, take this. The point is that the effect is there, even once they chanted the name of God. So it should be intelligently, there should be discrimination. Yeah. And besides, it might not help the devotion if you just directly tell them. And so, yeah. Prabhu.
Krishna Prabhu. So, the number six item, it says, one should not be under the spell of lamentation in loss or jubilation in gain. So, does it relate to the material jubilation or loss?
Yes, yes. Because you are still in the sadhana. Yes. Yeah. With Krishna, there is no way you can hold it back. It's that the do's and don'ts don't apply for Krishna. In the prema stage, they so naturally flow that even Krishna is not able to control himself, who is the controller of everything. And neither the devotee can control. So this is mainly like too much of lamentation in material gain or loss. They'll come and go. So the other point I find is that if you give yourself too much into this, then your faith will slowly get eroded. Today morning in the Bhakti Vaibhava class we were discussing, and Mataji brought it up, that they were devotees in ISKCON, and their whole focus was they wanted a son. And they were deeply desirous of it. When they had a son, the son was born with some congenital defect. And they became so overwhelmingly sad and disappointed that they gave up devotional service altogether and left the society. Because they said, how cruel is God? We asked him for a son, and now the son he gave us like this. And they left. So if it's too, one shouldn't give in too much. If you give in too much to the jubilation when the prophet comes, then you'll forget God. Loss. Just come and go, let it go. There'll be pain. Please understand, you are not, again, callous stones. But there'll be pain, but you should use that as principle as basis. Does that a little bit answer, or am I speaking too much? Let me know. I'll pause and tell a story.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. One question continuing on that point. So, related to lamentation, like, if you lose someone who is very close to you, naturally, as you're saying, we are not rocks and we have feelings, but what is that feeling related to? Is it, did we, I feel bad that I missed a chance to educate them about Krishna, or do we lament that, hey, I lost a close friend? And is it material lamentation?
It's personal. It can take many forms. It could be, yes, that regret might be there. It could be a personal loss. Or it could be, why I didn't collect the debt before the person died. It's embarrassing to ask his widow now to give the money. It could be. Please understand that Arjuna listened to the entire 2 hours of Bhagavad Gita, and he said, I'm free of doubt, I'm clear to act. But when his son Abhimanyu died on the 14th day of Mahabharata war, he was moved by tremendous amount of grief. So much so that there was grief, there was anger, everything came by. Next day, you remember the vow he took. I'll kill Jayadrath before sunset, otherwise I'm going to enter into fire.
So exactly, bro. So how do you explain his behavior? I mean, is he acting under his own terms, or is he put into act?
Well, loss of... See, in those days, it was unheard that the child died before the father. And for the father to take that loss was a tremendous amount of... It was a natural emotion, natural attachment. And besides, Abhimanyu also was a devotee of Krishna. So that devotional loss is there. My own son's loss is there.
But if we take that as like, I mean, yeah, everything happens according to Krishna's will. I mean, whatever happened is actually could be good for both of them.
Yes. Later he realizes that. Later he realizes that. He said, Krishna says, Abhimanyu was destined to die that day. It is nothing you can do or nothing I can do about it. I can do, but no, I did. Kind of thing. But please understand that Arjuna is an eternal liberated soul. So when they act sometimes like that, I have another question. Satyabhama, was she goddess of fortune or not? Yes. Why did she have this desire to get Parijata from heavenly planet? Why did Krishna has to go Garuda and then Indra is like, as usual, our little petulant child. No, I won't give. Flower.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
What is this goddess of fortune wanting a flower? What is it? Krishna feeling like a henpecked husband going to Indra and starting a battle. These are all divine pastimes of Lord and his devotees. So imagine the other option. That whatever Krishna wanted will come. Krishna didn't have to move. You know, he went to Dwarka and Sheshana came. He slept in Dwarka like this and everything was happening. It could happen. Well, where was the charm? Where was the sweet pastimes? Where was that reciprocation? So Krishna can do anything by his will. He could have stopped Abhimanyu from dying and that it's his divine pastimes that unroll. We are just part of it. So, there's a little bit answer. So please, I beg of you, let's... No. Suresh, no. Actually, it's okay. Actually, I would rather not do this rather than not answer the questions. No. Go ahead. No. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I'll not stop.
I didn't have anything.
Oh, you didn't have anything? Oh, you are thinking of our joke? All right. So, the next part. Did we go through all these ones before? We went through, right? Last class. So why don't we cover this and then we'll go to the 8th and then we'll take a little bit. So devotees can do 10 each, starting from... Yes.
The next important item.
No, not now. We'll continue with this and then we'll go to chapter 8. Sorry. Okay. Go ahead.
The next important items are as follows. Number 1, one should decorate the body with tilaka, which is the sign of the Vaishnavas. The idea is that as soon as a person sees these marks on the body of the Vaishnava, he will immediately remember Krishna. Lord Chaitanya said that a Vaishnava is he who, when seen, reminds one of Krishna. Therefore, it is essential that a Vaishnava mark his body with tilaka to remind others of Krishna. Number 2, in marking such tilaka, sometimes one may write Hare Krishna on the body. Number 3, one should accept flowers and garlands that have been offered to the deity and the spiritual master and put them on one's body. Number 4, one should learn to dance before the deity. Number 5, one should learn to bow down immediately upon seeing the deity or the spiritual master. Number 6, as soon as one visits a temple of Lord Krishna, one must stand up. Number 7, when the deity is being born for a stroll in the street, a devotee should immediately follow the procession. In this connection, it may be noted that in India, especially in Vishnu temples, the system is that apart from the big deity who is permanently situated in the main area of the temple, there is a set of smaller deities which are taken in procession in the evening.
In some temples, it is the custom to hold a big procession in the evening with a band playing and a nice big umbrella over the deities, who sit on decorated thrones on the cart of on the cart or palanquin, which is carried by devotees. The deities come out onto the street and travel in the neighborhood, while the people of the neighborhood come out to offer prasad. The residents of the neighborhood all follow the procession. So it is a very nice scene. When the deity is coming out, the servitors of the temple put forward the deity, put forward the daily amounts before them. So much was the collection, so much was the expenditure. The whole idea is that the deity is considered to be the proprietor of the whole establishment, and all the priests and other people taking care of the temple are considered to be the servants of the deity. This system is very, very old and still followed. So therefore it is mentioned here that when the deity is on stroll, people should follow behind. Number 8, a devotee must visit a Vishnu temple at least once or twice every day, morning and evening. In Vrindavan, this system is followed very strictly. All the devotees in town go every morning and evening to visit different temples. Therefore, during these times, there are considerable crowds all over the city. There are about 5,000 temples in Vrindavan city. Of course, it is not possible to visit all the temples, but there are at least 12 very big and important temples which were started by the Goswamis and which should be visited. Number 9. One must circumambulate the temple building at least 3 times. In every temple, there is an arrangement to go around the temple at least 3 times. Some devotees go around more than 3 times, 10 times, 15 times, according to their vows. The Goswamis used to circumambulate Govardhan Hill. One should also circumambulate the whole Vrindavan area. Number 10. One must worship the deity in the temple according to the regulative principles, offering arati and prasada, decorating the deity, etc. These things must be observed regularly.
Number 11. One must render personal service to the deities. Number 12. One must sing. Number 13. One must perform sankirtana. Number 14. One must chant. Number 15. One must offer prayers. Number 16. One must recite notable prayers. Number 17. One must taste mahaprasada, food from the very plate offered before the deities. Number 18. One must drink charanamrita, water from the bathing of the deities which is offered to guests. Number 19. One must smell the incense and flowers offered to the deity. Number 20. One must touch the lotus feet of the deity.
21. One must see the deity with great devotion. 22. One must offer arati, artik at different times. 23. One must hear about the Lord and his pastimes from Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita and similar books. 24. One must pray to the deities for his mercy. 25. One should remember the deity. 26. One should meditate upon the deity. 27. One should render some voluntary service. 28. One should think of the Lord as one's friend. 29. One should offer everything to the Lord. 30. One should offer a favorite article such as food or a garment. 31. One should take all kinds of risks and perform all the endeavors for Krishna's benefit.
32. In every condition, one should be surrendered soul. 33. One should pour water on the tulsi tree. 34. One should regularly hear Srimad Bhagavatam and similar literature. 35. One should live in a sacred place like Mathura, Vrindavana or Dwaraka. 36. One should offer services to Vaishnavas, devotees. 37, one should arrange one's devotional service according to one's means. 38, in the month of Kartika, October and November, one should make arrangement for special services. 39, during Janmashtami, the time of Krishna's appearance in this world, one should observe a special service. 40, one should do whatever is done with great care and devotion for the deity. Hare Krishna.
One should relish the pleasure of Bhagavatam reading among devotees and not among outsiders. One should associate with devotees who are considered more advanced. One should chant the holy name of the Lord. 44. One should live in the jurisdiction of Mathura. Now the total regulative principles come to an aggregate of 64 items. As we have mentioned, the first are the primary 10 regulative principles, then come the secondary 10 regulative principles, and added to these are 44 other activities. So altogether there are 64 items for discharging the regulative principle, the regulative practice of devotional service. Out of these 64 items, 5 items, namely worshipping the deity, hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, associating among the devotees, Sankirtana, and living in Mathura are very important.
So, that's the reason I... Anyways, never mind. What are the 5 important items of devotional service? Good one. What is ABCD? Yes. Yes. Nice. Nice, wonderful. Yes, yes.
So, Prabhuji, in point number 14, which says one must chant, and 43, one should chant the holy name of the Lord. So, they seem to be the same.
Yeah, so that's why I asked the devotees to read up till 8 chapters, because there is. There are so many similarly overlapping. Remembering the Lord and meditating the Lord, meditating upon the Lord. Then rendering service to the deity, touching the deity, or avaning archanam. So let's go read. So one... No. I didn't even answer his question. I'll come to you. Which is the numbers?
14 and 43.
14 and
43.
So if you go the further pages, so can we find quickly the 14th, explanation of 14th? Where is the 14th? It's on page 79, Sankirtana. Okay, one must chant, right? So it is, there is japa on page 80, right? Then, okay. Then on page 106, so couple of items Srila Rupa Goswami repeated just for to make sure that they are more important. So he just added couple of them. So if you can see japa on page 80 and chanting the holy name of the Lord on page 106. The other point which is also mentioned is that the holy name of the Lord can be chanted without regulations. And then if you really want the seriousness, then you can chant without offenses. So there is just added layer. Some have been repeated both for the common devotees and the advanced devotees. But having said that, can anybody write down all these questions and send them to me? Because I will do more study on that. Because there are some subtle differences. I caught few of them. I didn't catch because I was expecting more questions than I can. The reason is a couple of them. For example, remembering the deity and meditating on the deity. Remembering is that you remember Radha, Madan, Mohan in a very generic way. Meditating is more deep meditation on either one's position as a servitorship. So there is more of a relationship. So that is kind of meditation. And meditation is also, there are three or four types of meditation. So there is Shravana Dhyana, the Rupa Dhyanam means meditating on the form, Leela Dhyanam, so on and so forth, Charita Dhyanam, and so there are few subtleties like that. The other thing is being surrendering to Krishna and being a surrendered soul. There is surrendering to Krishna and then being a surrendered soul. There are the two different things. So it is mentioned Atma Nivedanam is surrendering to Krishna. But, you know, the Sanskrit word I remember, being a surrendered soul. Being a surrendered soul means thinking Krishna as one's protector and maintainer. I have no connection. I'm always protected by Krishna. I'm surrendered. But then Atma Nivedanam, or surrendering to Krishna, does not involve that feeling that Krishna is my protector. Bali Maharaj surrendered to Krishna, but he didn't have that feeling of being surrendered souls. There is a slight variation there. And again, living, there are three different things about living. Living in a sacred place, living in Mathura, three times it's there. So, the acharyas have explained that, you know, living in Mathura is, one should live in the jurisdiction of Mathura, which means not necessarily in Vrindavan, anywhere in the outskirts. So there are few subtle differences like that. Shall I tell you the very good news? You won't get this in exam. Because this is more for a Bhakti Vedanta and Bhakti Vaibhava and Bhakti Vedanta level, those subtle differences. You might get questions like, what are the five items? Because everybody should know what are the five items. If you don't know, then as I said in the last class, and what is the pure devotional service? Anya Vilashita Ashwin, you will nicely say, right? And then how do you do pure devotional service? Worship banyan tree. That's the only thing you need to do. It is there. Rupa Goswami said, worship banyan tree, one of the regulations. So you get the logic. If you put two and two together, what will happen? You will get devotion to Krishna. Only problem is, I need to find a banyan tree. Or Tulsi tree. For example, people can become, just worship Tulsi, that's it. You will get pure devotion to Krishna. No, but there are rules. Of course, it is possible. But nevertheless, Rupa Goswami says, read Bhagavatam. Worship the deities, associate with devotees, chant. Even amongst the five, which is the most important? Chanting the holy name of the Lord. As we go further, so please somebody collect the questions regarding few of the things. I didn't have the time to go more deeper, but I'll go more deeper and answer those questions. What was the question which the devotees asked? Which you asked, right? Which is chanting, japa? Yeah. Okay, I saw that. Few of the places I saw that. One should recite in a holy place. Then there are some, can you see there are some mutually contradictory things? What is the rule number 21 say? One? 21. Sridhar Prabhu, please go with your question. My apologies. While we are looking up.
Sorry, Prabhu. Actually, my question was that one of the point number 20 is one must touch the lotus feet of the deity. But to touch the lotus feet of the deity, you have to be second initiated.
Yes, yes. So that's Srila Prabhupada actually writes, saying that, you know, that's a good impetus to take second initiation. What does rule number 21 say? Okay. Okay. All right. Sounds good. So, please read. That's the reason why I asked you to read. The whole idea is that when you read, then you will get answers to that. I'll clarify the answers. Some are difficult, but most of them you will get answers by reading the explanations. Rupa Goswami didn't give the rules, pulling them from the wet, thin air. He based on solid scriptures, and he gave the explanations to those. Having said that, in exam you won't get question like, you know, one should see the deity with great devotion. Please get the exact verse which was quoted by Rupa Goswami. I don't know. Nobody will know. Don't even try. Don't even think. The idea is, when you read, try to come to the places where you say most important. Amongst these are the most important. Amongst these are the most important. So basically, if you see that our ISKCON movement, okay, you have to take Diksha. Why? It's there. That's why it is there. You read Bhagavatam every day. Why? You have to chant the names. Why? This is not like that is coming down from the bona fide disciplic succession, these rules and regulations. It is not done whimsically. So, let's go to page number 8. Let's do the offenses to be avoided, I know. And then, yes, Aditya Prabhu, yes, please.
In point number 6, says that as soon as one visits a temple of Lord Krishna, one must stand up.
Mm.
So, is it after bowing down one stands up, or that's little unclear?
So, it could mean multiple things. One time you stand up is, for example, there is an abhishek, and the deities are coming, then everybody should stand up. They shouldn't sit down. Quite few rules and regulations are not properly followed, which kind of pains me a little bit, but when you see the deity, of course you should stand up. When the curtains open, you stand up. So on and so forth.
Actually, we were standing and we actually bow down when the curtains open, so that was a little confusing, that's why. And then we stand up. So
sorry, I didn't get you.
So the curtains are closed, and then when the curtains open, everyone bows down.
Mm.
So it's a little confusing that it's here it is asked to stand up instead of bowing down. So that was the.
So stand up is a mark of respect, and then you can bow. One should also bow down before deities. It's mentioned.
I was also looking in page 76, Prabhuji, in the description, standing up to receive the Lord. So, I don't know if that's not directly related, but it's like when there is a Rath Yatra car festival, one stands up to receive the Lord. So, I don't know if that this description and both are actually different, because that's a temple and this is a Rath Yatra, it's like a procession, so.
Yeah, in the previous days, even still in Udupi temple, other places, every evening they take the Utsava Murthy out. They take it around the temple. So, some of these rules and regulations are not applicable in ISKCON, or you don't see them in ISKCON, because we don't take our Utsava Murthis every day out. So there are few discrepancies. So that's why, instead of getting bogged down, just five most important things, just try to stick to them. Other things are difficult. I'll tell you another. Actually, let's go. On page 69, what is the rule number 21 say?
Eulogize or praise anyone else before the deity.
So that is, yeah, so you should be very careful. In front of the deity is, oh Prabhu, you are so great. It's actually an offense to the deity. You should not. You should not. So what is the rule number 30 say in that section? No, rule number 30 in the same line.
One should not fail to offer some praise
Yeah, correct. That is correct. One should not offer to fail some praise. What if the spiritual master is standing in front of the deity? Then what? I can't pray. The rule says I should praise my spiritual master. He's in front of the deity. Nobody else should be praised before the deity except Krishna. Then what? Okay, go ahead. Let's have some fun.
So, both are correct. It depends on what is the bhav. If you only bow down to the deities, it is still okay. But if you bow down to the spiritual master in the bhav that he will be taking us back home, back to Krishna, and he is teaching us the Krishna consciousness, then because he is connecting us to Krishna. So if that is the bhav, so even that is correct.
But here is specifically more than bowing down, it's actually offering words.
Oh, praise.
Praise. You should not praise anyone else except the deities, but you should not neglect to offer praise to spiritual master when you meet him. Okay, you have few hands raised. Kolajipa Prabhu, Satya Prabhu, and then Leena Mataji. You have an answer? Okay, let's hear all the answers. I'm sure everybody has answers. We will come to your answer too.
I think Krishna will be pleased to hear the glorification of a pure devotee.
What's that?
Krishna will be himself pleased
if you glorify.
That's why in MSF offering, we first glorify Srila Prabhupada, and then we glorify His Grace Vaisheshika Prabhu also and the devotees who are participating in front of the deities to let Him know that, you know, these are the services done in a spontaneous manner to please You. I think by that we are pleasing Him also.
Okay.
So it's not that, I think here eulogizing means like you are praising someone for material things or maybe something which is not relevant to devotional service. It's my understanding.
Okay, good. Leena Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. What I was thinking that we should first begin with praising the Supreme Personality of Godhead, that You are so merciful that You have given us a spiritual master who will take us back to You. So that way Krishna will be pleased because we are first offering Him the whatever respects and like we are being grateful to Him. And then we are telling Him that You gave us the spiritual master who will be taking back to You.
Thank You.
So it's a like little maybe trying to be smart or trying to...
Okay. So having said that, okay. You had... No, you go. Then I'll ask Srinivas Goragaru. You go first.
Okay, Prabhu. Actually, I think all these rules apply according to Desha Kala Patra. Which is actually time, place, circumstance. So that is something that we need to consider, isn't it?
Ooh.
Time, place, circumstance.
Ooh, that's dangerous. I have to work 18 hours a day. Time, place, circumstance. I can chant one round and I should be done. No, then how do you define time, place, circumstance? How do you distinguish? Do you have that fine intelligence to discriminate between time, place, circumstance? That's my point. So because, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to put it that way, but you're right. That can be done in conjunction with your spiritual master. You should say, this is the situation, do you approve of this? So the guidelines can be in conjunction with Guru.
Like for example, Prabhu, whenever you see a spiritual master to fall down like a danda, which is dandvat pranam, but then that's not possible all the time because, you know, if he's busy, he may not be able to. So it's not like every time he comes to the room, you just fall. Like that's not something.
No, it is.
Like
it doesn't need to be that he needs to acknowledge every time. It is your duty to fall, you fall. Whether he sees you or doesn't see you, it doesn't really matter. But having said that, in front of the deities, one should avoid. That's another point. It's in the ISKCON temples, at least, you know, from my perspective, I strictly actually forbid anybody doing that when I come into the room, because it's only for the Supreme Personality, or it's an offense actually to do it. So please don't do that. It's only for Krishna. This is, he is his kingdom. This is, we are all his servants. So my request is that, if you can, mentally you can offer prayers. That's another point. You are in front of, the spiritual master is in front of the deities, and you should not eulogize anybody else. One way you can do is do in a visual way, just, you know, with acknowledgement and with gesture, without saying a word. You just indicate your gratefulness to the spiritual master. The other thing, as the devotees pointed out, is you praise for the benefit of the deity. You glorify his devotees, because Krishna says glorification of my devotees is better than me, or higher than me. So in that sense, if you glorify, that's fine. But if you don't have that consciousness that this is belongs to Krishna, and he is the, most often that's my fear. Because we have temple activities, more often than not, so many times it happens that we even forget that it's for the deities. It is for the pleasure. They are the kings and queens. They are to be served. So that consciousness shouldn't be lost. Then it will just become more of a social and offensive way.
Prabhuji, one more question.
Yes. Can I take the one on the Hare Krishna online? Anybody? Did anybody ask online question? Srinivas Garu, did you try to ask? Okay, good.
Okay, Prabhu. So, in the same chapter that we are looking at, there is one rule that you should not wear three-lined tilaka. But then in Ramanuja Sampradaya, they wear three-lined tilaka.
This is for Gaudiya Vaishnavas.
Okay.
Also, Prabhu, in...
No. Ramanuja also wear three. One white, two white, and then red in the middle. Yeah.
Also, in connection with this, also, isn't it mentioned that we should not treat spiritual master as any other normal human being?
Yeah.
He is, Krishna says that he's a representative of Krishna.
So yeah.
In that sense, even if we offer obeisances or praise to our spiritual master in presence of Krishna, so would it?
It's a little controversial, honestly speaking. If the spiritual master gives the order that you should never do it to me in front of the deities, then you should follow that. But if they don't, then it's the individual spiritual master. I don't want to comment on that. But strictly the spiritual master should say that never ever do that, because in front of Krishna, I am also a servant of Krishna, servant, of my spiritual master. So that focus will be always, when we are in the temple, it will be always on Radha and Krishna. Because that awareness will be there that, you know, they are the supreme most personalities, and everybody is their servant. Ashok and then Dhiraj.
Prabhu, in this chapter 8, I wrote some questions. So, rule number 10, one should not lie down before the deity. So, we all... Is it like sleeping, or lie down means sleeping?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah. Okay. You shouldn't lie down before the deity. You shouldn't sleep before the deity.
And number 11,
one
should not accept prasada, right? So by closing curtains, is it acceptable, or we do all the time, right?
Again, you know, usually in other places, there was never question of eating. If you go to Tirupati, can you eat prasada in the main temple? But it's such a huge complex, and they have like prasadam halls which sustain thousands and thousands. So is also Mayapur and other places. Our ISKCON temple, because of the lack of space, we have to make this arrangement. Strictly speaking, we shouldn't be eating anywhere here also. But it's just the adjustment that needs to be done. And I think because ours is a preaching movement. Yeah, but if you go to any big temple, Srirangam or Jagannath Puri, anywhere, you never eat in the temple premises.
So. Prabhu, rule 21, so again we discussed that, but we should not even praise devotees, right?
Yes, that is the other thing. You know, I'll go a little more deeper into this, but as far as I remember, ideally you should praise only the Lord in front of the deities, saying Krishna. There are so many rules here. One should not chastise, one should not speak a lie. You'd be very careful about that. One should not speak a lie before the deity. One should not quarrel or cry or howl. There's so many rules there. Some rules are applicable and they can be followed. One should not be charitable before beggars, before the deity. One should not speak harshly before others, so on and so forth. One should not pass air. That's another thing. If you have to, it's urgent, go outside or hold it. But you shouldn't pass air in front of the deities. Everybody clear out? Okay. Yeah.
Prabhu, page 70, rule 5.
Yeah.
One should not break silence while worshipping. Can you elaborate that, Prabhu? Is it like break silence in the sense should not be?
I'll have to look it up. I don't remember.
Page 17, number 5.
I know, second paragraph. I've seen that. Probably we'll discuss that next time. I don't remember it on top of my head and I don't want to give any speculative answer. Let me see. Some of them are time from Jiva Goswami, where if you do the puja, then you know there is a certain time of silence that you have to do as a part of that puja. You don't speak. So there are some minor rules and regulations. But in the modern times, yeah. But I'll double check with this. I'll let you know. I don't know on top of my head.
Okay, Prabhu. Page 71, rule 28. So is this in reference to Shaiva Tilak or Sri Vaishnava Tilak?
Both. One should not decorate his forehead with a three-lined Tilak. This is both. Now don't, I have, yeah, I, the, it's both. Basically we shouldn't put three lines. I can't take one more line and put it in the middle.
So, in that connection, Prabhu, so my mother is coming from Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya.
That's fine.
So, if they come to temple, like...
It's okay. These are minor rules. It's fine.
So, the last question, Prabhu.
Yes.
Page 71, second paragraph. One should not worship the deity before a non-devotee. So, is this applicable at home also, Prabhu?
No, these are rules for the temple. These are mainly for the temple, not for the home. Obviously, you know, if you have in the middle of worshipping your deity and some non-devotee comes, you can't say, wait, stand outside for 10 minutes, let me complete. Or you stop your deity worship. So it's not practical. So it can continue at home.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you. These are all the rules for the temple. Yes.
So... we were reading Chaitanya Bhagavat and there was mention of, you know, putting tilaka on your body.
Yeah.
And there Srila Siddhartha Saraswati Thakur in Parpati mentioned, like if someone sees someone wearing tripundra, he should immediately run and take bath. So he was specifically mentioning about, you know, Lord Shiva's worshippers.
Right.
So to clean yourself, you should take bath in a pure water after looking at that. So it was very strong in his experience.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was quoting some shastra in that regard.
Okay. Thank you for pointing that out. I did not know that. And the only thing I remember from Chaitanya Bhagavat is Mahaprabhu chastising a student for not putting on tilak. Okay. Yes.
So Prabhuji, we read about not eulogizing other in front of the deities. What about offering obeisances? So when we offer obeisances, we said vanchakalpatur obeisya. So does that come? So I think like my understanding was we cannot offer obeisances to each other in front of the deities. So,
ideally you should not, but if the spiritual master comes, here is the thing though, the instruction says that you should, if your guru comes, even if you are doing deity worship, then you stop the deity worship to greet him. So, in the temple, if you offer obeisances, one thing to look at it is to offer obeisances to Paramatma from within, to everybody who comes, rather than to the spirit soul. In that sense, you are not neglecting to offer respect. At the same time, you are not giving not respect or disrespecting the Supreme Lord, because you are seeing the same Paramatma. So that can be one mode of how you can offer obeisances. Yes, Kaladvipa Prabhu, you had it.
In that regard, I can remember one incident. I was in Krishna house at the time, so there was a class, and suddenly a sannyasi came and a lot of devotees gave prostrate obeisances. And then I asked one devotee, like, you know, why you are doing immediately inside the class. Then he told, like, you know, in the Shastra it said that if you see a sannyasi and you don't give prostrate obeisances immediately, you should fast all day to counteract the sins you acquired by doing so. So I was just...
Yeah. You might question then, you know, if some exalted personality walks through the door and we are having a class and I offer obeisances, that's because of a sign of etiquette. It's a sign of respect. Even if you don't offer obeisances, at least stand up and do this. So it's important that you show some respect. In front of the deities, you cannot disrespect his own devotees. That's another problem. Okay, Dhiraji.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
In the previous section, there was a point mentioned on which I request some elaboration, if you can. It said, one should take all sorts of risk and endeavors for Krishna's benefit. So, if you could go in depth.
And the prime example is Srila Prabhupada. He came to West in 1965. Practically, the risk was enormous. There was practically no... He was bound to fail from a material perspective on all levels. But yet he took that risk for Krishna and it came out well. Jatayu is another example. When Sita was being kidnapped by Ravan, Jatayu stood up to challenge. He knew that there was no chance of him winning against Ravan. He was old, he was frail, Ravana was extremely powerful, but nevertheless he took that risk for the Lord. And he is glorified forever as his devotee. So, from our perspective, you are saying, oh, okay, big, big things. From our perspective, once in a while, if you have to go from work early, only if for a genuine reason, don't take it as an excuse to get out of work every day 3 o'clock, thinking I'll do all sorts of risk for Krishna. Because you can do it. Don't get me wrong. But later, if you have that strong faith like Srivas Pandit or Srivas Thakur, where, you know, he has that story, if you have that faith, then do it. But most of us are not on that level. So let's, you know, keep our external perspective in place. Once in a while, you have to take off early and there is work at office. And then you say, you know, that's it. I had that experience personally. I was to go to Boise. And I had to catch a flight at 5 o'clock to be with Hanumat Prishak Maharaj. I had to meet him. And immediately on that evening, there was some upgrade going on. And my boss said, you know, you have to stay to work. I was in a dilemma. You know, I prayed to Krishna that I have to go. And I told him, you know, it could be a risk that there could be some negative consequences. But I told him, you know, I have to catch a flight. Very nice, but I told him I had to catch a flight, I had to go. He said, okay, and things work out well. So it's more of one's own state of consciousness. And if people say, okay, I'll take a risk, here is the contradictory. One should take all sorts of risk for Krishna. One shouldn't construct opulent temples. One shouldn't construct opulent temples or get involved with two big, big projects. Isn't that like contradictory? Depends on our state of consciousness. oh, I can build a big temple for Krishna, I have that capacity to get money and do. That is one way. But this is another way is, you know, I don't want to, but I have to. I want to do this for Krishna. When push comes to shove, what is your choice? Want to go this way or that way? When you go this way, then Krishna will take care. But out of our own egoistic way, if you try to build temple or something like that, that's not our endeavor. Does that a little bit answer your question?
Yes, thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you. Yeah, but let's not push the risk. That's my point. Because we're not there. And the thing is, when you are there, it'll automatically come. You just will walk away happy, with no regrets. I've seen many times that people, they neglect their duties in the name of service. And later, when negative consequences come, they blame God. Why did you do this to me? I did this for you. Why? Krishna never said you take that kind of risk for me. Do it in a reasonable way. But even if you do it, and you are at that elevated state, even if you do it, you will die happy. Jatayu was not regretting that, why did I kill myself for Ram? I knew, I'm a foolish fellow. Why did I take panga with Ravan? I know that I can't get win. I am old, I'm useless. And he was happy. He was so happy seeing Lord Ram. And then he said, this is what happened. And then, you know, he died in a peaceful way. Grateful that his life was used for service of Lord Ram. If we reach that level, yes, we can take all sorts of risk. Not before. Gauravji, is that okay? More questions, comments. A couple of, please, somebody write me those questions. I'll do a little more research into it. Then I'll come back to you.
I have a quick question.
Yeah, Leena, okay.
Prabhuji, can you elaborate on the point number 21?
21.
It's definitely not for us, for the neophytes, but it's for the brahmanas, but can you elaborate? These days people, instead of smearing their bodies with oil, they apply the lotion, right, after taking bath. So,
I don't know, I'll come back to you. I never even thought like that. Seriously, it's an awesome question. First time I'm thinking, you're right, people apply lotion all over. Can they apply deity worship after that? Or is... I'll come back to you. I have no answer for that. I mean, so usually in the previous days, they would give an oil massage. They would take oil and put massage, and then they would take bath. So part of the restriction is that you just don't get a massage, apply all over your body, then go deity worship. You better take a bath, clean yourself and go. But lotion, I don't know. It depends. Actually, lotion is a depending thing. You know why? Here is the thing. You take bath and you have to go do aarti. And there is a whole Sunday feast crowd here, 100 people watching. If you don't put lotion, you'll start itching. Then you better apply lotion and go, because it's used in service of God. Exactly. So it's a time place thing. It's like, oh, my skin will get so soft. I need everybody should see my glowing skin. Then don't apply lotion. So it depends on why you apply in the first place. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, I went to the Parthasarathi Koil in Chennai. Last time when I visited. So, you know, after the darshan, I immediately did a dandavat pranam. And people got really upset there, because you're not supposed to do dandavat inside a temple at all. You're only supposed to do in the dvajastambha.
I see.
So, that's like, for us, we have supposed to do dandavat the moment we see the deity.
That's my point, though. Supposed to do, it's not mentioned anywhere in Rupa Goswami's rules and regulations. There are five types. No, there is Panchanga and there is Dandavat, which is Ashtanga. You say.
it may be dandavat or it just, you know, any kind of namaskar, any kind of, you know, you're not supposed to do inside the temple at all.
I think it's just a local restriction, I guess. I don't know why.
So, you know, everybody got upset, like everybody lying in the line, they got upset. And then one lady said he doesn't know. So apparently in Ramanuja, in school, you're not supposed to do any kind of namaskara inside the temple. Other than the obeisances, you're not supposed to do.
Obeisances?
Like, you know, you just do a...
Fold your palms?
Hold your hands, that's it. And the namaskaram you're supposed to do outside in the Dvajastambha.
Well, I heard, you know, when we have yatras by Radhanath Maharaj, you're not supposed to offer obeisances in the temple at all, any temple you go. You know why? Save time. Because everybody offers obeisances and there are 6,000 people waiting. You get the idea. I could be wrong. I could be my pure mental speculation. Probably it was thousands and thousands of people and they would forfeit their chance if they took time.
I did ask the reason for that. They said that no matter how you do namaskaram, your feet are pointing to some deity there.
Oh, interesting. Okay. That's another point though. So, yeah. So, here in our temple, you can't avoid it. Seriously, if Vaisheshika Prabhu is sitting here, you point your feet, you're pointing to Vaisheshika Prabhu. You point straight again to Prabhupada. You point that way to Bhagavatam. Sorry. What can we say? Yes, Leena Mataji. And
so,
then Simanti.
Prabhuji, what do we do? Three sides you said we cannot point our feet. Fourth side we cannot do. So what do we do?
Usually it's personal choice, but what I do is that if there is a speaker here, then the usual etiquette is that your left hand should be pointing towards the deity when you offer obeisances. So that is the etiquette. The deity you should offer left. But when the spiritual master is sitting here, then I would rather risk it and offer it with my right. I bow down like that. So I don't, because it's a greater offense to show the feet to the spiritual master and it's really not acceptable. So I point like that. I don't have a choice.
In that case, we don't have the option rather than pointing the feet towards Srimad Bhagavatam.
There's no other option.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you. Yes.
Hare Krishna. I have two questions together. The one on number 13, there's one should not enter the temple wearing garments of red or blue color.
Yes.
So mostly sometime for festival time, we choose those colors. So should we stop doing it?
No, it's fine. That's at least ISKCON GBC law doesn't include that. I don't know why it is mentioned. I have to look it up. Red and blue. I must have looked it up, but I've forgotten. But red was like the color of Shaktas in those days. So when you go to the temple with Shakta clothes, that was not. Blue, who wore, I don't know. I have to find out that. But from the modern perspective. Mataji, here everybody wears jeans. It's blue. Most of it, time at least. Again, there are minor rules, there are major rules. Let's not major in minor rules. The reason I'm saying it is, please don't get scared by these rules. Because the prime of all rules is to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. If you can get that done with attention, with concentration, Rupa Goswami says, and we learnt in Nectar of Instruction, that your entire material existence is destroyed. But having said that, when you know these rules in the temple, you consciously avoid offenses. Some offenses you can really avoid in the temple. So, like, you know, yelling in front of the deities, or praising others, telling a lie in front of the deities. So many things we can avoid. So that's why when I say in the Bhakti Shastri classes, I'm in front of the deities, I can't tell a lie. This is where it is coming from. What's that? I want to hear something truth about the exam. The truth, the complete truth, the whole truth about the exam is I have no clue what is going to come in the exam. At least till now. Except one question that is going to come. You better read up. Huh? Good. At least if you take away that, what is pure devotion to Krishna? That's all we need. That's all we are here for. I'll never remember those rules. I'll never expect you to. And I definitely won't get the question Sivanthini was asked. Why is it that you should not wear red and blue in the temple? Can we carry dyes and then dye the pants before you come to the temple? Or saris? Our husband asks the wives, wives ask the husband. Or in the Mexican people put those ponchos. Like put all those things, I have red and blue over it and I cover it with yellow. You look like a bunch of clowns. Yes, Mataji, one more.
Yes, Prabhu, and it's just so many rules here. So how important are those rules for our devotional service? Because sometimes we will follow, okay, we shouldn't do that, we should do that. Like we'll keep remembering all the rules and probably we'll forget our major purpose. So my question, how we can use those rules nicely in our life and not hamper our most
excellent
important
question.
Part?
Super question. Mataji, if I understand you right, you know, yeah, I know the rules, I might not be able to follow it. And then if I don't follow it, what is the impact on my spiritual life? Krishna is Bhavagrahi Janardana. He knows the intention within our heart. And to the extent you can follow, that is fine. To the extent you don't, you know, we understand. But the five rules are important that needs to be followed. And amongst them is the chanting. Remaining rules, wherever we can, we should follow. Wherever we cannot, we should beg Krishna for forgiveness. That's why, wherever... Vaisheshik Prabhu says you can chant a chapter a day just to, if you still feel there are any offenses that you committed against the deities, to overcome those offenses. But no, they won't seriously impact if you are not deliberately doing it or doing it out of accident. One should not pass air before deity. That day you had garbanzo beans and that's all you had all day long. Yeah, in the aarti and it happened. What are you... keeping it inside, collecting it up can be a serious health issue. So you use time, place, circumstances to determine. That's where Sridhar Prabhu, you don't have to consult your spiritual master. Some places you can use. This is there. Don't pass air before the deities is there. I'm not making it up. So, so you, based on that, you know, yeah. So, yeah. So if you are in the doing pujari service, don't eat too much garbanzo beans. Yes.
So Prabhuji, for one point where it says you should.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Hare Krishna. For one point, it mentioned that you should not sleep where deities are. So that means you should not keep any deities in the bedroom at all, whether it's Krishna, just the yes. artwork or anything
yes.
at all.
Here is a dilemma. I am a student, or I can afford only a studio apartment. I sleep there, I have received guests there, I work there, I worship there, then what? So in that case, yeah, and if you can afford it, definitely don't. If you cannot, then you can't help it. For example, you are sharing a room. You are a bachelor, you share a room, and you are sharing with a non-devotee. Because they cook all sorts of stuff. And then you want the deities to be here in somewhere close. And so based on time, this is the rules for the temple. At home, it's based on our best of abilities that we can do. Here, if the deities are there, I can't put a pillow and blanket and sleep right there. That is an offense. So the next time when we have Bhakti Shastri class, I won't have it at 2 p.m. in the afternoon. Or make it lively. So on that note, I'll do one joke and then we can do. So a man, he loves garbanzo beans. That was his favorite thing. But there is a concomitant side effect to that. So that was his birthday. And he consumed a lot of garbanzo beans. He went to work. There, everybody knew he loved garbanzo beans. Everybody got everything made of garbanzo beans. By the time evening he came home, serious problem. So his wife actually said, his wife said, I have made a special romantic dinner for you today. And then as soon as he comes home, and then, he ties thing and then goes sits on the dining table, and then it's a surprise. And then the man says, oh, okay. And then he could hear his wife cooking in the kitchen and he's in the dining room. There was a problem. He had to relieve himself. So he relieved himself once, twice, thrice, about 10 times it happens. And then the wife says, please open the thing. And he opens it. He sees all of his friends and relatives ready to give him a surprise birthday party. Happy birthday. Did the wife also give them nose clips? I don't know. Anyways, so, man, we told too many jokes. I shouldn't have told too many jokes. Questions? So, reciting notable prayers. We have prayers, prayers, Srimad Bhagavatam, there are so many other prayers. There is, on page 91, there are few things that is really nice. Expecting Lord's mercy. Sridhar Prabhu, please open that 10th canto, 14th chapter, 8th verse, please. 91, who is supposed to read next? Oh, Gaurav? No, actually, so the reading, done? Manu Mataji is done? Okay, Gaurav. So you can read the entire thing, let's wait for the verse to show up. I want everybody to repeat this verse. 10:14:8. 10:14:8. Okay, kindly repeat after me. Tatte nukampam susumekshamano. Bunjana evatma kritam vipakam. Hridvagvapur bhir vidadan namaste. Jivetayo mukti pade sadayabha. Okay, Gaurab, please read.
Krishna. In the 10th canto, 14th chapter, verse 8, it is said, My dear Lord, any person who is constantly waiting your causeless mercy to be bestowed upon him and who goes on suffering the resultant actions of his past misdeeds, offering you respectful obeisances from the core of his heart, is surely eligible to become liberated, for it has become his rightful claim. This statement of Srimad Bhagavatam should be the guide of all devotees.
Can you please read that again?
Okay. In the 10th canto...
No, just that statement.
Okay. This statement of Srimad Bhagavatam should be the guide of all devotees.
Thank you.
A devotee should not expect immediate relief from the reactions of his past misdeeds. No conditioned soul is free from such reactionary experiences. Because material existence means continued suffering or enjoying of past activities. If one has finished his material activities, then there is no more birth. This is possible only when one begins Krishna conscious activities, because such activities do not produce reaction. Therefore, as soon as one becomes perfect in Krishna conscious activities, he is not going to take birth again in this material world. A devotee who is not perfectly freed from the resultant actions should therefore continue to act in Krishna consciousness seriously, even though there may be so many impediments. When such impediments arise, he should simply think of Krishna and expect his mercy. That is the only solace. If the devotee passes his days in that spirit, it is certain that he is going to be promoted to the abode of the Lord. By such activities, he earns his claim to enter into the kingdom of God. The exact word used in this verse is Dayabhak. Dayabhak refers to a son becoming the lawful inheritor of the property of the father. In a similar way, a pure devotee who is prepared to undergo all kinds of tribulations in executing Krishna conscious duties becomes lawfully qualified to enter into the transcendental abode.
Nice, huh? So, because one of the questions people ask is that, you know, even though I am a devotee, why am I suffering? Or other words is, they seem to be enjoying, but I have taken up devotional service, I am suffering. So, how is it? So, the attitude is, because Krishna gives a little bit of suffering just to purify us. But there is no hope for those who have not taken shelter of Krishna to ever come out of this entanglement of material world. Birth and death, repeated birth and death. Really, we don't want that. You know, some little bit of suffering he might give because of our past karma just to purify us. But they actually become the stepping stones of success. Because Krishna is seeing what's your attitude. Is your attitude like, you know, God should be my order supplier, he should be always giving me nice, everything nice? Or is it like, you know, I'm ready to be tested by Krishna? What is my attitude? Pardon? Give and take. Questions? You had a hand raised. Okay, Gauraji, you had a hand raised, sorry. Sir.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. So, we get reactions because of our sins, correct?
Yes. In the ordinary course, yes.
But as we say, if we surrender to the Lord, then we become sinless.
Yes.
So then why should we get reactions?
Good question. I'll ask a true or false question. Does Arjuna or does Krishna address Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita as Anagha? What does Anagha means? So Pandava should have never undergone a single trouble. I think they didn't, right? From the birth till they fought the war, and they were undergoing one severe tribulation after another. Why? Though they were sinless. So by Krishna's mercy, in fact, it's the other way around. Kunti says, give me more. Why? Because the idea is that it's natural psychology that even though one is sinless, when one is faced with a troubling situation, one remembers Krishna even more deeper. And Krishna's remembrance becomes stronger. And Krishna just tests his devotees in that sense. But he gives them the strength. Never let them perish. So, and going back to your statement, when you surrender to Krishna, immediately you will be cleansed of sin might not be the correct assessment. No, immediately. That's my point. The material nature is so strong. I surrender to Krishna, but you know, it's like we have 6 stages of surrender, right? So we have to progress through those 6 stages. I surrender to Krishna, which stage are you in? Well, I am Anukulyasya. I don't know. Well, then you will need to get little more lessons from Krishna on how you surrender. So it's a time. It's going to be taking time, and Krishna gives accordingly. When his exalted devotees like Arjuna and others, they had to suffer. Prahlad had to suffer. Then ours is not much. Our father is not trying to put us in front of elephants and put us into oil, burning oil, taking us to Golden Gate Bridge, not to show the Golden Gate Bridge, jumping. So we are okay. Is that a little bit for us? For us? Okay. All right. Yeah. More questions, comments? 10 more minutes. What's that? What's that? Translation? Yeah, the translation is there as a part of this. That's why I didn't read the translation. So it's one of the prayers by Lord Brahma. And actually it's very profound. He says, you certainly become the rightful inheritor. Just stay in that mood, you'll get it. So powerful it is. That yes, you gave me this. I don't know what all mistakes I did. I don't know what all sins I did. For how long I have been doing it, at which point in my life I did. But you know, you give the perfect reactions. I accept it and I surrender unto you. Krishna's heart melts by that kind of attitude. He is completely charmed by that kind of, you know, behavior by his devotees. And he'll say, yes, I'm going to take him back. Yes, to an extent, yes. But then Ananya Chintayantamam is more like, you know, if you think of me, then people might say, oh, you always think of Krishna, then what are we going to do about your food and 401k and medical insurance and your car bills? Krishna says, I'll take care of it. It's more from a lacking, this is more from a really troubles perspective. I mean, what is my attitude? Yeah, you can say it's a complimentary thing. Nice, thank you. More questions, comments? Yes, Dheeraj ji.
Prabhuji, just on this same page, little bit ahead, in the remembrance section, it says that it is mentioned in Padma Purana that let me offer my respectful obeisances unto the Supreme Lord Krishna, because if someone remembers him, either at the time of death or during his span of life, he becomes freed from all sinful reactions. So just by remembering Krishna, one can actually be freed from all sinful reactions.
They get destroyed. The more you remember Krishna, the more your sinful reactions get destroyed.
So is there a spectrum of remembrance here? Like, because it simply says if one remembers Krishna, then so...
So Srila Prabhupada writes in the Bhagavad Gita, 8th chapter, if you go and see how many times he quotes, the best way to remember Krishna is to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. It's the easiest form. But then as we think more of Krishna, the thinking becomes concentrated, 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 to the point you can't think of anything else except Krishna.
So at that ultimate point, everything is destroyed?
It is destroyed, but even in the ordinary course of activities also, in the fleeting moments that we think of Krishna, hey Krishna, save me, or oh Krishna, you are so wonderful. Oh, Krishna, what did you wear today in the temple? What color dress were you wearing? I want to see, and they go see. So that just burns up tons and tons of karma within you, just by remembrance of Krishna.
So it is not that just in one go of remembrance, all sinful reactions are burned. You're saying it's gradually a process?
Yes, to the extent that when you constant, because when you think of Krishna, in the conditioned stage, you still commit sinful acts, or you might think of something else. So, you know, it has to go beyond that, and the focus should be constant. To the point that Shishupal and Kamsa thought of Krishna always.
But unfavorably.
They're completely absorbed in thoughts of Krishna. And when they were killed, did they go to hell? They merged back into body of Krishna. Because they were purified of all sinful reactions by the remembrance of Krishna. Somehow or other, if you can remember Krishna, then your sinful reactions are destroyed.
And then in the next section of meditation towards the end, it is mentioned that according to Vedic literature, meditation is always on the form of Vishnu. So is there any special meaning or distinguishing here, or it's the same?
Vishnu and Krishna is one and the same. I'll give an example. Okay, 5 more minutes and then we'll stop. So on page 86, seeing the deity. Everybody there? Page 86, that will be, and for Sridhar, that is further consideration of devotional principle. Chapter 9. Everybody there? Okay. Sridhar, search for seeing the deity, yeah. Seeing the deity. Seeing is enough. I think you should get there. Yeah. Let me read that. In the Varaha Purana, there is a statement praising the seeing of the deity of Sri Krishna in the temple. A devotee says there, "My dear Vasundhara, any person who goes to Vrindavan and sees the deity of Govindadev is free from the courthouse of Yamaraj and is allowed to enter into the highest planetary systems which reside in the demigods." So here, when Rupa Goswami quotes this verse, we are wasting our time uselessly, seeing Madan Mohan. He says, go to Vrindavan, see Govindadev. If you take it literally like that, so we should immediately book our tickets to Vrindavan and go and see Govindadev. We have to escape Yamaraj. We are wasting our time. Jaipur. But the point here is this is quoted by Rupa Goswami for Govindadev. Hare Krishna, Akrunath Prabhu. Welcome. Thank you. I'm almost done. Give me 2-3 minutes. We are done. So Lord Vishnu or Krishna is one and the same. Rupa Goswami writes in the Nectar of Instruction, there is no difference between Vishnu and Krishna. So when we get a quote saying that seeing Govindadev, one frees from Yamaraj, it's the same as seeing Madan Mohan here in ISKCON, Silicon Valley. So that is the intent. So when you meditate on the form of Vishnu or Krishna, it's the same. But as we advance in devotional service, the Lord reveals Himself according to the form that one's Ishtadev or one's, you know, constitutional form that the Lord is meant to be served in. So, yes, Srimanti Nivasji.
Prabhu, so
if somebody going on with his sinful life and in his mind, okay, in a month or year, I will go in front of deity and pay obeisance with my full heart. So is he will be get same result that who is strictly following all regulative and not going on a sinful life? I mean, you understand my question.
I understand your question.
Yeah.
Srila Prabhupada actually writes in the purport that those who are demons and who still think of Krishna, but they perform their sinful activities, it is mentioned that Krishna gives one lifetime of hellish life for them, or hellish demoniac life, before he reclaims them back. So if the devotee goes trying to cheat Krishna, okay, I continue with my sinful activities, and once a month, it's same like our, so many places Srila Prabhupada condemns that kind of mentality, you know, Christians going to confession and so on and so forth. You know, let's be very clear. Are you trying to cheat the supreme cheater? Are you trying to find a loophole in his system? So he will reward accordingly. He is supremely intelligent. So best course of action is you be as sincere, as straightforward, even if you are full of sin. Krishna, I am full of sinful tendencies. My mind is strong, I can't overcome it. Please, I beg you to help me. And if you're in that sincere state, if you just pray and you know, reveal your heartfelt emotion before Krishna, Krishna will make sure one way or other that sinful tendencies go down gradually. If your sincerity is not there, God, I have come once a month, okay, I'm showing you my face, I'm really seriously doing, then you know what, I want to keep the way my lifestyle. Then Krishna will say, all right, keep your lifestyle. I'm not going to interfere. More questions? So one last before we go. Should we have one more class or we are done? We ready, go directly to the exam. Three? Two. Three will be too much. We'll have one more class, and then, you know, based on how much we cover, we'll have one more max. Okay? Then we can please keep all your questions ready. Read up, and July 10th will be the exam date. It'll be in the temple. Ashok Prabhu, one last question, and then we should let Akrunath Prabhu.
Prabhu, that same question, blasphemy of Krishna or his
yes,
devotee.
Yes, thank you.
And following also, like during Radha Yatra in LA, right? Mm-hmm. So we will face some kind of these things. So how should we react?
Okay. Sridhar Prabhu, further chapter 9, the same, please go all the way up. So Akrunath Prabhu, I'll quickly read this.
Please take your time.
Okay.
We have a long time before our
okay.
Because,
so blasphemy, because one of the rules and regulations is one should be very intolerant of blasphemy of Krishna or his devotees. So, reading from the 9th chapter, one should not tolerate blasphemy of the Lord or his devotees. In this connection, in the 10th canto, 74th chapter, verse 40 of Srimad Bhagavatam, Shukadeva Goswami tells Maharaj Parikshit, my dear king, if a person, after hearing blasphemous propaganda against the Lord and his devotees, does not go away from that place, he becomes bereft of the effect of all pious activities. In one of Lord Chaitanya's Sikshashtaka verses, it's mentioned, the devotee should be more tolerant than the tree and more submissive than the grass. He should offer all honor to others, but he may not accept any honor for himself. In spite of Lord Chaitanya's being so humble and meek as a devotee, when he was informed about the injuries inflicted on the body of Sri Nityananda, he immediately ran to the spot and wanted to kill the offenders Jagai and Madhai. This behavior of Lord Chaitanya's is very significant. It shows that a Vaishnava may be very tolerant and meek, foregoing everything for his personal honor, but when it is a question of the honor of Krishna or his devotee, he will not tolerate any insult. There are three ways of dealing with such insults. If someone is heard blaspheming by words, one should be so expert that he can defeat the opposing party by argument. If he is unable to defeat the opposing party, then the next step is that he should not just stand there meekly, but should give up his life. The third process is that followed is that if he is unable to execute the above mentioned two processes, then, and this is that one must leave that place and go away. If a devotee does not follow any of the above mentioned three processes, he will fall down from his position of devotion. So, a quick recap in Srimad Bhagavatam, there are all the instances mentioned here. In the fourth canto, when Daksha was performing sacrifice, and when Shiva failed to stand up and receive Daksha, and Daksha insulted Shiva, then Nandi, Shiva's bull, cursed and counter-cursed Daksha because he couldn't tolerate the offense against his master. So that is one way of saying it by words. Sati, who was daughter of Daksha, she went to the arena of sacrifice where her father was performing. And when she found that her own husband had no place and he was being insulted, she gave up her own body. And in that connection, Srila Prabhupada writes, based on your varna and ashram, then you can decide. The third most extreme example of actually killing an offender is also there in Srimad Bhagavatam, where Vena is killed by the Brahmanas because he was blaspheming the Supreme Lord, saying that, you know, you Brahmanas are worshipping Vishnu. Who is Vishnu? I am your Lord, I am Vishnu, so you should worship me. And they immediately killed him. So based on your position, you should, but for a devotee, for us, it's better to walk away. It's better to close the screen on internet. It is better to stop that YouTube recording or whatever. So any blockage of that content through any form is advisable rather than the other. We need you here, so please don't kill yourself and please don't kill others. That way also you will go to prison and you will miss your service. Akrunath Prabhu, you had any words of advice or comments on that, how to deal with the blasphemy? Please give Akrunath Prabhu a mic.
I thought you dealt with it very well. I think that, we should make sure that we don't become at all contaminated by it. Mm. So the best thing to do is to just leave the place immediately and not engage with them. There's plenty of opportunity for us to actually approach innocent people and tell them about the glories of Krishna, or also to go visit with devotees and discuss the glories of Krishna like we're doing here. So we're advised to avoid the demoniac people, the envious, those who don't like Krishna, those who are envious of Krishna and his devotees. And even in the society of devotees, sometimes emotions get high and quarrels break out because it is Kali Yuga and we're not all perfect, and maybe this is some kind of pastime or something, I don't know.
But, no, yeah.
But we... But it's better for us, you know, because we have plenty of positive devotional service to do. And it's very important that we get the positive devotional service done. And now that the internet is available and it's a place where people like to just post their opinions and they say more quickly than they think. And sometimes their opinions are hostile or angry or, you know, or just a little bit in the mode of ignorance or in the mode of passion or something like that. But it's better not to get engaged in that because it could be, of all the things in our spiritual life, we could commit some mistake, engage in some bad habit, sense gratification, something. But if we actually commit offenses to pure devotees, then that can destroy our devotional life. And it's very, very dangerous, and we're warned to be, you know, very, very careful not to do that. So getting involved in quarrels with devotees, it's better to just avoid it. Wonderful. Even if you think you can defeat them, it's probably just going to get another quarrel.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. So we'll stop here now. And so maybe in 2 weeks' time, then we'll have... Shyamalangamati will send out an email. So we'll try to cover the last... in a nutshell, cover the last four chapters, and then we can take some questions. Is that okay? All right. Thank you.